So today at this presentation, we are going to actually see how Cloud Run is the rise of serverless and containerization. And this talk is brought to you by Cloud GDEs and all the folks that actually help to build the Cloud Run community as well, because we are actually a community. So a bit about myself. My name is Marton, and I'm actually Hungarian, but I'm living in Romania. So I am in the middle of Transylvania region, and I didn't meet Dracula. I have read and hear about all kind of historical events that Dracula is present of. You should visit it in order to see the castles and all the mountain hikings that is available for you. So about me, in my professional way, I have a strong Stack Overflow profile, and I'm a Google developer expert on cloud technologies since 2016. So it's 5 years, 4 or 5 years, something like that. I work at a local company, at a Romanian company called RIA. We have offices in the country as well and abroad as well. We had the Swiss office as well in the past. And my favorite tools, and I use a lot of BigQuery and Redis. So those two things are actually my true expertise, but Cloud Run is something that we use frequently. And I put together some interesting info about Cloud Run and the newest features in the serverless world. I have two stage names. One is Marton Kodok. You can find me on SlideShare and Twitter on those. And the other is Pentium 10 for on Stack Overflow and GitHub. You can find me using those stage names. So today, Cloud Run, the rise of serverless and containerization. And we are going to see what is serverless and what are serverless pain points. We are going to see how Cloud Run brings containers to serverless, or serverless to containers, whatever the order is. And we are going to see some best features and practical use cases I have prepared in order to demo how easy it is to work with Cloud Run. As I hope that this group and the current audience is already at day three of the Cloud Run week, they have heard a lot of introduction about what is serverless, what is Cloud Run. I will do only a bit of slides, what are important for us and why we have chosen this as our operational model, for example. So if we are talking about serverless, it's very important to understand that you don't need sysadmins, how I say. You know, you don't have infrastructure management, and all the work developers can actually do and develop it. Nowadays, there are developers, DevOps, sysadmins. There is a mixture of things inside your organization or the companies as well. But the operational model is actually no infrastructure management. It has managed security, but you should pay attention and secure your application as well. There are interesting features about that. That was covered, I think, yesterday in the security session. And it's pay only for usage. So that's what we love, because it can scale down to zero and it can scale up to 250 concurrency like requests in a second by default, but more as well. In the programming model, it's service-based, so you need to actually assemble all your application as a service, but you can assemble in a service multiple sub-applications. So if you have that route of development, you can do that as well, because people tend to use a lot of services, but also we can actually take a few services and compact as a single service, in order to yield better uptime and better memory optimization for that. It's event driven, Event-driven means that whatever event are in the cloud or in your organization, it's a suitable programming model in order to receive and work on the event model as well. Now, next, I think what's most important is that serverless pain points. So there was a study in 2019 at Serverless Days Milano, and that study actually revealed a couple of pain points that serverless is giving us or to the audience that was at that conference. And the top of the options was cold starts. Now, we will see later in the talk how Cloud Run have taken cold starts and how actually mitigate all the cold starts to a lower and lower level. The next one is vendor lock-in with almost 21 votes here. So with vendor lock-in at 2019, there was no way to actually assemble a serverless application as a container, and it was much more or less function-based. Or let's say the full app with highly limited libraries and dependencies that you couldn't use. It was only a limited way to develop application. Cloud Run, we will see how it addresses this vendor lock-in by using containers and actually offering you a way to actually run Cloud Run, run in the cloud, also containers on a managed and or your own infrastructure. A couple of other options in the pain points are organizing and tracking functions. This was totally eliminated by introducing containers, and containers are actually a folder from your PC or a build that is going to be used in order to get to the container contents. And some others are that, let's say people don't use serverless. This is an interesting category because we need to actually talk to them, see what they miss from the serverless pain point. And whenever Cloud Run was launched, by containers, and again, containers is the answer that, hey, in the containers, you can assemble whatever you want, and that will be actually your application, and you can actually run anything in serverless. So, next, containers. Literally, I don't want to talk about containers. I just want to mention that you can write and you can assemble a container in any programming language. You can have any library as a dependency, any binary, and it, let's say it has an ecosystem of base images, but those base images are something that you frequently use and now are services that scan your containers in order to get updates if you use an old unmaintained base image as well. But anyway, containers is a topic that in 2021 is already highly discussed, and it's actually evolving to a level 2. We will see next year's how containers are going to be faster, lighter, and let's say much more a fewer stacks in the containers. So, Cloud Run, bringing serverless to containers. Let's dive in. What is Cloud Run? Cloud Run is a product of Google Cloud Platform. So, in order to use it, you first need to understand how Google Cloud works. And that's extremely easy because it's extremely developer-friendly, and you need to add your credit card in order to run a little example, but Cloud Run offers you a 2 million requests per second as a free option. So you could actually start out with a free plan if you have never used Cloud Run. and it provides you container to production in seconds. So it's a feature that it has auto scaling up and down as well. With auto scaling up, you are actually, when you have a campaign or a trending topic, it will automatically scale to the limits that you set or the default project or organization limits from your higher level of organizing projects. If you have a, let's say, a bigger project or a corporate company, it's natively serverless. So it means that you need only developers, and it has a different paying model. And basically, you get all the features what serverless means, and it integrates also in a managed and in your own environment, in, let's say, in a Kubernetes environment as well. And of course, one experience where you want it. So that means that you can run in managed environment and in your own clusters as a Kubernetes extension. It's called Kubernetes extension. So if you are new to serverless and you want to actually see what compute options there are, you will probably notice, and you know that there are functions which are actually source-based and mostly react to HTTP and some kind of events. Then in the Google Cloud platform, there is App Engine, where you actually have a way to have a serverless application by instructing the Google Cloud platform what kind of engine to run in the background. For this engine, you need to pay, let's say, 24/7, or you need to start stop for it. It has auto-scaling, let's say, at some point, extremely good for an application that has, let's say, static contents or literally just a bunch of front-end applications and doesn't run, let's say, too much on custom code. And it's great for async code as well here. And again, it's source-based, so you need to upload your source as well. And then there is Cloud Run. And Cloud Run brings serverless and HTTP workloads. And it's no longer, let's say, source-based, it's container-based, and it's great for HTTP async and events as well. Containers are actually the source of your Cloud Run instance. So I prepared the demo in order to see how to run your first example, how to use this example as getting started on Cloud Run. I will be very quick in order to see how it goes. What I'm going to present to you right now is actually it's a much more than a demo. So I use Visual Studio Code, VS Code. And if you see here, I want to show you a couple of things. One is that I've installed a quick run extension where I can actually set some commands that when I click it, it automatically runs the action and the command. And then I'm able to actually quickly do a deploy and do a submit as well. These commands are actually described by the VS Code and task JSON. And this VS Code task JSON is defining what kind of options are in there. So for example, my Cloud Run deploy action is executing gcloud run deploy a name, the current folder, and some additional parameters in order to be it as a quick action to run it. Then there is another action, cloud build submit, where you actually use the same gcloud and using cloud build in order to launch your submits. You should check it out. It's extremely simple and it's very, very, very helpful for me in order to run a couple of commands. Next, eventually people say that it's really hard to notice how you change projects. And for that, I actually developed an extension. And here, for example, at the clouds, in the status bar, at the cloud icon is my the GCP project. And when I click this, this project is opening in order to choose a project from my user as well. So this is an extension I have developed. You can find the extension on the marketplace. It's called the GCP project switcher. It was launched 4 months ago, and you should check it out how to speed up your VS Code development time in order if you run, for example, multiple projects. In the status bar, you have the project displayed. And in the refresh button, there is, let's say, a refresh, a force refresh in order that the cache if doesn't pick up a newly created project as well. So demoing Cloud Run. So I prepared you a very basic demo, which is a Node.js folder, which is in here. It has a Docker file. As I mentioned, it has a base image. It sets the working directory, and it copies the current folder into the working directory, and it runs npm start. It has just a basic file. Normally, it has a package file as well. And let's see what it does. Now, in order to run it, I can use the action from here, but for the folks that are never seen a command launching a Google Cloud Run command. So basically the command is gcloud run deploy one. And here what you see is that the service is being assembled. So it uploaded the sources, which is, let's say, my current folder, because it was that source is my current folder. It's building a container using cloud build. It provides you an URL to monitor the cloud build, for example, for errors or for time consuming operations and caching inefficiency, that kind of information you have there. Once it's done, it sets access policies. It creates a revision and it routes traffic. And what you see right now is that in a couple of seconds, you will have a demo application. And here is our application. It provides you a default URL, and the application is here. Hello, GDG Nantes and GDG Cloud Abidjan. I understood that's the community of yours for that. And normally, as you see, it provides out of the box HTTPS. It provided a domain. You can add a custom domain as well. And if you want, for example, to add a new content, like I added 2021. Now this time I'm actually clicking my action here. So let me clear the terminal window. And now I click deploy, and it's creating a new task window, like a special task here, in order to execute it separately from my terminal. And it's automatically in the background, it will create the project and run and update my application. So while the demo finishes, I want to show you a bit the interface as well. So this is Cloud Build. And this is our coolant build, which is in progress. You are able to actually see here all the logs that are used for building our containers. What was the source? If it was a build pack used, and something have failed here. So it's actually great that this example is something that I have used, and in order to show you that in case you get into the trouble, then here you are able to actually see the errors and figure out what's not working. So essentially, what didn't work is that my project is in a folder, and I run the command in a folder that was not available. So that was my problem of that command. So again, now it's running in the correct folder, and in a moment it will finish, this time hopefully correctly. Yeah, it's doing already the second step. It's done and it was successful. Now, if I refresh the application, we should, yeah, it's done building, but now it needs to deploy it, right? So I refreshed the application, but it was still the old version of yeah. So the application is up. And if I refresh it, 2021 is there as a new content. It's extremely easy if you start with Cloud Run. Now, let's continue further with the presentation because there are interesting things here. So, serverless Cloud Run, you can run in two places. Let's say it's one is the fully managed way, and this is on Google Cloud Platform. It's fully serverless. You don't need to manage any clusters, pay for what you use, what limits you set, and you are already running in a couple of seconds. And then if you have a Google, let's say Kubernetes engine, and you have a cluster, or you have set up Anthos and you are running on premise as well, you can set up in order to have a Cloud Run service inside your cluster as well. Now, I will focus mostly on the fully managed interface, as all the examples and advanced topics are on the fully managed way. Per use model, very simple. It counts the CPU memory requests for the duration of your request, but minimum is 100 milliseconds for this. And you have, for example, here a chart that says that there are some cold starts. This is the first gray area. Then if there is coming a request and finishes at some point and another request meanwhile is being served, then it doesn't build the sequence of the time. It's actually building the longest time that the service was active. And then eventually it waits for another request, and if it doesn't come to another request, it could shut down in case if you have a different setup, like the default setup, it could shut down. There are options to actually keep it there. Now, pricing, it's just for the forks that are starting with Cloud Run. Basically, it offers you 2 million requests per month. It offers you generous gigabyte and CPU tiers in order to get it started. I would say that if you have around 300 billion requests, is something that gets at the scale of running your own VMs or running. Running your own cluster, it works running the managed Cloud Run environment. Now, what makes Cloud Run the king of serverless compute? Let's see. So, first of all, let's talk about dependencies. Legacy solutions restrict you to use the tools provided. So actually, you need to have either a certain Node version or a certain Python version. You cannot use a custom things on it. But actually, Cloud Run brings flexibility to any dependencies and binaries of your application, as it has container. And in the container, you can put whatever it is, regardless of your language and runtime of your code. So essentially, people, for example, if they are run a Node runtime, you can add a Golang binary in order to execute something using the Go runtime environment. Then there is testing. And testing is something extremely important in serverless way, because you actually need to make sure that whatever you deploy is accurate. And there are not the best tools in order to reach out in a stateless environment and do debugging for a serverless way. So here often other cloud providers offer emulator, even Google Clouds offers emulators for some of the services as well, because you have the ability to test both locally and in the environment and in the cloud. So there are actually three tiers of testing levels as well, but it could actually yield to a problem. But as I noticed, and I already told you, containers are actually bringing a lot of action into the segments because they make the testing experience a lot more consistent. What that means, it means that whatever code and dependencies is being packed together at the developer point is the same as in the production environment. So essentially, we have eliminated by using Cloud Run moments of works on my machine, and it doesn't work on the production machine. So essentially, turning to containers and running in Cloud Run results in a fewer works on my machine moments. These are actually great occasions in order to see how different builds are actually going out. Now, whenever we test something, we need to control traffic to it. And traffic controls are something very important to understand and to use it, because I've seen people running Cloud Run and they don't use traffic control. They always go with the, let's say, latest version. So serverless tools, if we are talking about, let's say, functions or other environments, often don't provide canary deployments only to a subset of traffic. They provide, let's say, all the traffic, all the events for that. For example, there is a high request feature that the cloud function should be disabled or be something like that. It's routing and so on. So it's a different topic, and hopefully we will see it in the future as well. Now, having the traffic control in Cloud Run allows you to actually set a control for the revisions of a service. And this actually makes you available to do gradual rollout strategy. It means that you could develop and you could deploy one version with a flag no traffic, so it won't add automatically nothing as a traffic to that environment. It means that it will provide you a single URL where you are able to run your first request. And why I'm mentioning the first request? Because often people need to run database migrations or anything state and any state migrations. And when you want to run database migrations, you don't want to run that on the flow of the user. So it would be it would add a lot of latency if you would check for migrations in a live environment. So that checking and running the migrations, it should be done on a candidate with a no traffic. Once you get past to the migration and init phase, you can, for example, set up as a candidate and you can direct a couple of percent of your traffic to it, and it would gradually roll out with a automatized script like a cloud workflow environment in order to see when you could, for example, set up for run it 1 hour in a candidate, for example, 10% of your traffic, and you set up a KPI indicator that actually tells that the candidate is healthy. It didn't produce, for example, errors. Latency is on the average compared to your production environment. And you could set up an automatic way to gradually roll out strategy. Now, if you want actually to try out this gradual rollout strategy, search on GitHub there are open libraries in order to that automatically will set your cloud run in this way of working, and they will automatically promote a candidate to the latest version, which actually runs 100% of your traffic. But you could build out your own environment, and you could tie a bit of services on Google Cloud Platform as well. Like you could use a cloud workflow, as I mentioned, in order to trigger it, put it in a database, or put it in a serverless way, like Firestore, a flag. And as a scheduler, you could check out that its setting, it's the set is there, and it the averages and in the state of health and KPI indicators are actually matched. And when it matched, you actually promote the candidate to the latest environment. Now, with containers, portability is resolved almost all the time. There are some limitations like access to GPUs, access to some disk environments, special environments, but it's actively requested, and hopefully it will be implemented soon, because that's all the things that actually are missing for the portability platform. Now, traditional function as a service platforms are a vendor lock-in. You need to understand how to execute the environment, how to deploy it, and you could not, for example, move from one day to the other cloud vendor in another on-premise environment without rewriting some of your algorithms. And this actually, I say that it's a huge disadvantage. And when I figured out that Cloud Run resolves this problem with containers, we no longer run, for example, function as a service platform only when there is a project which needs a function to trigger something very, very rudimentary, very primary stuff. That's when we run a cloud function, like, for example, setting a header information like the cache value of a file on a CDN, for example, to be cached for 30 days or for 300 days. That little piece of code, for example, we run in a cloud function, but it could be moved into a container and a service as well. For portability, container are resolving your environment, your own environment, and you can deploy anywhere. It could be on-premise, VM, Cloud Run, Kubernetes, GCP, AVS, Azure, whatever platforms we actually name. And having Cloud Run containers results in a service that doesn't have a vendor lock-in. And I've seen this slide, for example, is very, very handful for managers, because developers are actually just focusing on developing machines, but managers want to figure out what could they do in case of a disaster recovery, or what if the upper management decides that we want to move the application from one vendor to the other, and we are not prepared for that, because there could be an organization that runs legacy code, which could be 5 years old, or it could be 10 years old. It may not be even containerized. So people, wake up. Containers are a thing nowadays, and you need to use it on your projects. A couple of practical use cases, because this was some of the features that we use and we love Cloud Run. And actually, we have lived the rise of serverless and containerization. I have already mentioned that mitigating cold starts is one of the key factors that people address questions and they want in a serverless way to be handled correctly. Let's see what it goes. What's in this slide? So there are the general stuff where you need to use a linear base image, Alpine distroless scratch, and use statically linked binaries. But there are studies as well that some of the options are better and so on. So it, in a performance way, you could test this, what works out for you and what capabilities you have in order to see the fixes, the change logs, and the security updates of the base image as well. Then in the application level, there are people that tend to use a global scope. It's interesting to mention that Cloud Run, it's, let's say, designed for stateless operation, but a container, as we will see in the later slides, it can handle not just one single request, it can handle multiple requests in the same container, and then you are actually able to fructify and to actually leverage this advantage for your own application, where you declare some cache reduce in order to reduce latency. But there are features that are created for you and that are minimum instances. With minimum instances, you are able to set a minimum number of pre-started containers that are there and waiting for traffic. It could be 2, it could be 1, it could be even 10. And you could actually set up, for example, just before a campaign or a trending stuff that you actually wait for happen. How we use minimum instances? We use minimum instances, for example, when we know that we are going to send out a large email campaign. A large email campaign for us, it means that we send out 30 million of emails and we expect around 10% of clicks from the email, which results a lot of requests on the site, usually nowadays immediately or in the next hour when the campaign launched, or if the campaign runs midnight at the first office hour, like 8, 9 a.m., 10 a.m., those kind of hours. And then we are able to engineer our platform that for duration of that, let's say, period where we expect the campaign to be launched and have a heavy traffic, we set out minimum instances. And once the campaign is out, we actually turn off this feature. So we don't keep it, for example, always there. For this use case, we have a different use case as well, where you have minimum instances up and running. Minimum instances has a cost, but it has 10 times less than a regular price. So let's say that you can run 10 minimum instances to the one single wall price, and that's amazing option in order to consider it. You need to investigate and run your own numbers in order to see how it's benefiting from your application. But you are in the cloud, you could architect when minimum instances get used and how they are starting up. So you have a couple of ways to actually define these. The easiest one is the UI, where you have the minimum number of instances set. And then you have two ways to actually do from command line or from automation. You could, for example, run the services update, and here you set the minimum instance value. This is very frequent because you have the services ready. And when you know that you are deploying a service just for that campaign or just for that purpose, you could, for example, deploy an image with the minimum instances for that. For example, again, there could be an email campaign hitting a page, and when the campaign is set up and the campaign is started, there is a warm-up phase which actually sets up the instance where you have the landing pages hitting, and you could, for example, have that specific service for that, you collect a lot of metrics from that service because you know for which campaign it was, what was the top traffic on it, and you can actually span out as well. You use minimum instances just in the beginning, and then you fan out in order to be no minimum instances, and automatically Cloud Run will auto scale down to zero for you, so it won't add too much traffic. And now we have reached auto scaling. Auto scaling, hopefully you know that it's a thing of the cloud. You probably have already used it. It's an awesome feature. I want to actually name a couple of numbers and thresholds that are important to consider on Cloud Run environment. So it scales down to zero. It has a cost savings. This is actually great for occasionally campaign-based services, which, for example, we use Cloud Run on one single project. It's also good for hobby projects where you could run a personal blog site, for example, almost in the free tier, or it's very few bucks, for example. And you could, for example, remove some of the services, or you could group some of your services in a way. What we have seen having a problem is that people tend to abuse this kind of service thing. They tend to use custom domains, and there is a limitation in the number of custom domains. So that's when you are reaching limitation in the custom domains, you are combining services. Now, each service can scale by default, and it's important to understand that if you don't tweak any values, by default, 1,000 container instances. If you are an enterprise and you need more, this can be increased. So that's actually a good thing. Now, the third one, each container instance can handle up to 250 simultaneous requests. This is a feature. I say that this is a positive and a negative as well, because if you, for example, run WebSockets, those are eating a lot of connections. And for that, it's extremely good that you can run from a single container 250 simultaneous requests. But be aware that if you produce the number, you see that you are setting up a platform which runs 250,000 simultaneous requests. And that is huge. And it's providing you risks that your bill will be, I don't know, a couple of thousands of dollars in an hour. And watch out if you didn't configure well your service. Let's see what's that and how you could do that. Concurrency. Traditional function as a service frameworks have a fixed concurrency of one. Whenever there is a function, it's called one time, fires up, stops. That's the concurrency of one. But Cloud Run enables you to set concurrency. Default is 80, and it can be increased up to 250. Even with 80, you could have a service that accepts a lot of traffic, and you could be DDoSed, and your bill will be extremely high. There are topics and blog posts on the internet about a trial experiment with a bill that $72,000 overnight, and that was actually a huge and a good experiment for that. The common errors are what I've seen in the past and what I'm seeing on Stack Overflow, for example, where I answer questions, is that there are uncontrolled retries and failing loops, which could be, for example, induced by some failing test, and they retry, or they don't implement, for example, a backoff. The backoff is very important in order to slow down an effect. For example, if you produce a bad code on Friday and you are going to fix only on Monday, you could have a way to mitigate some of the cost by using a backoff. Then there is unwanted traffic, and let's say DDoS as well. where you could actually set up different services in the cloud environment in order to reduce some of your problems. You could run identity aware proxy from some of your private services or control services. You have cloud endpoint service connecting with different keys and front ends. And if you have a DDoS, then you have the cloud armor as a way to mitigate these services. These services cost each service, if each product costs you money. So pay attention to what additional costs will add to your project, but also to the benefits of risking to having a $72,000 bill overnight for that. It would be, for example, interesting to hear your experiments of this and if you have run into unwanted bills or unwanted billable content using Cloud Run, because I want to actually hear about your scenario in order to know what to do. Now, I just want to show you a couple of, actually two comparisons here, how concurrency affects your bills. So if you leave concurrency one and you have, for example, three requests across 400 clients, then you will have 520 instances running up. But if you raise the concurrency to 80 and clients is the same and the number of requests are the same, you will get only 150 instances. Here, the less is actually better, because remember, I told you that you are actually paying memory, CPU as well. So even if the request number is the same, you are paying memory and CPU only for 150 instances and not three times or three and a half times more, like 520 instances. So it's very important to understand. On top of that, when you are increasing, for example, concurrency, you need to be aware that your container runs in a bubble, let's say, in an environment, and that environment has a CPU and a memory attached. And you need to set up your application in a way to actually fit into that memory that you have set for that environment. And here people actually separate some of the services in order to be low profile and high profile in order to set a service that uses only a few gigabytes of memory and a service where there are the highest usage of memories. We often separate instances based on memory, and we have a lot of, let's say, backend backbone processing where we need additional CPUs, and we set a bunch of CPUs in order to be faster, for example, converting something that's extremely CPU-based. Good. You can add additional load balancers to it. It provides you, an inbuilt custom domain for you outsource. But for example, if you set the load balancer, you are able to actually set up a serverless network as well, and you could have a different URL map with a backend service for mapping different services to different ULS. You could accomplish this also with cloud endpoints as well. But what I want to show you is that if you add a load balance, then you are actually able to run multi-region load balancing with Cloud Run, which means that you develop an application and you deploy, for example, to Europe, and you deploy also to US East. And whatever user is, so if the user, for example, is in Norway, in Oslo, they are routed into the Europe environment. And if the user is from the US, they are routed to the US environment. And this is extremely helpful because it reduces a lot of latency. Like across the ocean, there could be like 100 milliseconds latency for some users. And if they are from mobile, even more. So you should use the services in order to have in a different region. It actually costs you the same, even if you run in, let's say, in Europe and in the US. There are a bit of fractions of converting euro and dollars for you, but essentially it costs you the same. And why not run close to the user for this? Also, for example, we are using this kind of load balancing for multi-regions where we are able to detect that there will be a campaign for a specific country, and then we are able to actually set on that region the number of services and the number of minimum instances differently. We run a platform which has a lot of users and across the globe, and we see traffic starting, let's say, with Australia, then Asia, and then Europe, and then US. And there are different services controlled and run dynamically for this operation. Another demo. I want to demo WebSockets. And for WebSockets, I will actually choose something available for you as well. There is a whiteboard demo. Essentially, you need to run three commands in order to actually get the demo up for you, and it will demo WebSocket as well. You need to clone socket.io repo from GitHub. There is an examples and a whiteboard project in order to get to the source code, and then you can actually deploy that into the internet. Let's see this demo, how it works. So I already cloned socket.io examples whiteboard. So essentially, I'm into this folder, and now I want to actually run a whiteboard demo. From this folder, and this actually runs extremely quick, and it deploys the service into my test environment and into my workshop project as well. Hopefully it will be finished soon. So once again, yeah, it should be done. Let's wait for it. Okay, it takes longer than I expect, but it should be up soon. Come on, let's check what's there. Cloud build, go back. It's still running for some reason. It takes a lot more. It finished. So meanwhile, it finished. So it will need to see the routing as well. Now, while it does that, let's see what's next. Actually, it's one more slide, the conclusion as well. So if you have questions, post in the Q&A tab in order to answer it. Now, this is whiteboard, and let me open that again in order to see WebSockets. Not that like that. So WebSockets, it means that it's fully connected. So for example, if I start to draw something with green, what should I draw here? Like an A, you see? It's in the other window as well. If I here, I want to do something with blue, then it's B and C, for example, and underline. So essentially, WebSockets are a feature of Cloud Run, which opens you, for example, to build out canvas and all kind of applications that are serverless, and they are for a purpose. It's extremely flexible, and it could be service based as well. It could be like an example, and it could be for purpose as well. People forget that they need the manager in order to approve them, for example, cloud space or cloud services. But for example, in Cloud Run, they could provide you access to services. Now, I'm going back to my presentation and conclusion. So I put here my advantages, and I want to talk about only mine as well. So it uses a simple UI and CLI in order to quickly deploy managed services. It integrates with Cloud Code, Cloud Build, and other continuous deployments that I love when they kick in action. When I commit something or I merge something, they kick in action. It has a fast auto-scaling. It's extremely fast. I never imagined like in 10 seconds or 20 seconds, I'm able to actually set an auto-scaling to a service. And of course, scales down to zero, which we frequently use like fanning out the campaign, starting high and then fanning out to zero. And actually, we end up removing the service from our stack as well. Redundancy, as services are replicated across multiple zones. It provides out-of-the-box HTTP endpoints and custom domains as well. And it provides you a decent number of custom domains. So actually, you can run a lot from there. And it has a invocation available by HTTP2, WebSockets, gRPC, and nowadays, it provides you additional security as well, like VPC and other controls for you as well. So essentially, this was my presentation about Cloud Run, the rise of serverless containerization. And let's see now what kind of questions we have in the chat in order to see them addressed.
Thank you, Martin. Okay, I've seen some question. There is no vote on it, so I will take the last one. There is a question about concurrency and latency. How does concurrency impact latency? I think it was about your study case and case study. And
yeah. So let me take that and answer that. So I will put it. So first question, concurrency. Yeah, you have asked that if concurrency impacts latency. That depends on how you set up your container. So if your container has a limited memory or limited CPU to handle, let's say, 250 requests in parallel, it will affect latency. For some, let's say, something big services like transforming an image, building a PDF, it could be an issue in order if you run, for example, 250 concurrency for a container. But you can actually figure out that level of threshold where you set the concurrency, and you could raise concurrency in steps in order to ensure that you don't affect the latency of your application. Often people forget that the container is itself the container, and what happens inside the container is their duty and their job to understand what's going on there. And it's not the serverless platform operator. The platform operator is actually routing the traffic and putting the hardware on it. So it's great. Another reflection on latency, we have migrated PHP applications, for example, from AVS VMs, and on Cloud Run, they run super fast. So whatever underlying infrastructure and hardware put out Google Cloud there is great, and it's extremely, extremely fast. So we were able to set concurrency up to the roof in order to ensure that the application runs nice. We fit into the memory limits of our application, and we are running it fine.
Okay, thanks for the answer. Yes, one question for me. Are you thinking about creating a FinOps recipe for Cloud Run? I see you used to get some really cool case studies about the way you architecturing the solution. And do you have some a recipe about the FinOps part of Cloud Run or something like that?
So we have not documented the architecture and the steps that we do. First of all, if we do that, let's say professionally as a company, we need to have the accept of our client if we actually detail it, because it's, let's say, talking it broadly about the concept is fine, but detailing is something that we want to do. We are trying to do, but let me explain that we are not doing it ourselves, but we work with a client in order for them to publish as a white paper the solution with the help of our engineers.
Okay.
With the recipe and all the collections, we haven't explored that. There is a Cloud Run FAQ.
By
Ahmed, yeah. So you could, for example, check out this, which is a section that already has a lot of people on it. And here, why not, we could add another chapter about sharing architecture and implementing, linking to the articles as well. What I wrote about are on my Medium, so you can read about Mediums, but not most about Cloud Run. There are mostly about different services as well.
Okay, thank you. I will just push the link to the FAQ in the chat. Yep. Yes, another question from me about your VS Code extension. Do you try Cloud Code, the official extension for VS Code, or do you prefer your own tasks?
So Cloud Code, I would say that it's too much for some people, and it's not clearly explained that you can disable some of the buttons, because you could right click and disable it. What I found out that I'm actually a much more versatile DevOps engineer, and I want to define my own ways of run the project, and I don't want to depend on Cloud Code features as well. Literally, we script a lot of things. So essentially, Cloud Code as a environment for us is great, but we use Terraform, we use scripting as well. And traditionally, even we started to use, let's say, workflows nowadays in order to integrate much more faster because workflows, for example, don't need update. We define the language and it stays there like 10 years. In Terraform as well, you need to update sometimes because it changes libraries and so on. So that's why, when people don't run, for example, Kubernetes, they only run the cloud. For them, my extension of switching projects and actually seeing which project they run, it's extremely helpful. It minimizes the clutter on the VS Code environment. For them.
Okay, thank you. there is another question about GKE versus Cloud Run. Is there recommended use cases?
That's
a big question.
That's something that we need to develop further. I would say that I am not the best person to come up with best use cases because we have only explored GKE and we have not migrated something from Cloud Run to GKE in a production environment. So essentially, try to figure out if you get the session, for example, GKE enterprise faults that are able to provide you an answer what it works there and what's not. And essentially, I see that there are a bunch of people here, so who has some good use cases for this, eventually put it in the chat because I'm interested as well to find out a topic about this discussion.
Okay. Last question for this session. For the people who don't use serverless from the survey you show at the beginning of your talk, what the first feature or what are the main the key feature you try to sell to the top manager to try to adopt the serverless paradigm?
Yeah, so first of all, it's a shift of mindset. And we engaged the managers with a totally different concept, and I'm happy to share this. So we engaged the managers that we developers want to work on fun stuff. And in order to work on fun stuff, we need to have access to modern tools, which are, let's say, serverless, nowadays Kubernetes. And we push the managers that we can do the same service in a much modern environment. And for them, it will be, let's say, cost almost the same. Some of the services are actually cost a lot less, but we have a lot of operation. So essentially, if we, for example, add our hour of the hourly rate to the bill or the operation that we run, it could be a different number for having that. But again, we migrated to the serverless environment because we wanted to work on fun stuff. The other, what we have seen is that we tend to provide and put out services with our for that targeting a specific feature or a specific campaign of the application and not the world. So whenever they set up a campaign or an A-B split test and they want to collect some metrics, for that we set up a little service that deals with that. And when they stop it, because when they stop it, we remove it. When they keep it, we could integrate that service as part of a larger code base and run on the production environment as well. So those kind of ways that we deal with the services and serverless and our managers as well.
Okay, thanks for your answer. So I think it's all good. Thanks again, Martin, for being there tonight. And I think everyone, I enjoyed your talk, and it will be available on YouTube, I think tomorrow or Friday. And I will tweet the link on the GDG Nantes Twitter. So thanks again, and have fun with Cloud Run, and see you tomorrow and Friday to continue the journey to this adventure.
Thank you for having me here. See you at next occasion, next conference as well. Follow me on Twitter. The slides, I didn't tell you, that are on the slide share. So for example, if you want to check it out, they are already on the slide share as well. And you are able to see and click back the slides as well.
Bye, thank Bye. You.
Change of number.